Everyone who successfully arrived at the conference did so thanks to K-Itinerary, which is not the topic of this talk. So we're going to talk about energy consumption instead. Volker.
Thank you. So, yes, following a bit on the previous session, how can we actually measure the energy consumption of the stuff we built? To get started, why do we care about this? Yes, multiple reasons. There's, for example, the battery use on battery powered devices, so the mobile case that we discussed earlier, right? So if you use less energy there, the battery lasts longer, clear, tangible benefit for the user. Another thing is performance, right? So all the electrical energy we put into a device comes out as heat again. If it doesn't come out quickly enough, the device throttles down. So if you put less energy in, that happens less often, we get more performance out. And then, of course, the climate impact of energy use. On that subject, I can recommend you to watch some of Joseph's talks if you haven't done so already. He has some actual numbers in there. I think the IT impact is in the same order of magnitude as transportation and aviation combined. So that is a lot. And worse, it's rapidly growing, right? So there's definitely something we need to do about that. How does software impact the actual energy use? So how can we change this? There's, of course, the obvious thing, right? Every instruction the software sends to hardware requires energy to be executed on any kind of hardware. But there's also less obvious things beyond that. For example, power management settings, right? So if there is hardware that you currently don't use, that can be switched off. A lot of this is transparent to our level of software, right? That happens somewhere on a kernel or driver level. But in some cases, that also benefits massively from more context. Say, for example, you can switch off the display backlight much more aggressively on a lock screen, while compared to when you're watching a video, right, then you probably shouldn't do it at all. So we can also provide useful impact on that level. Somewhat related to that, the idle behavior of software, right? So what does the software actually do when it's supposed to do nothing? More often than not, it's actually not doing nothing, but it's continuously looking if there's more stuff to do. And that means the hardware actually wakes up, checks if there's stuff to do. And that means we don't get to the highest power save states, and again, waste energy there. I mean, realistically, we are going to talk about very small quantities here. So is this even worth the effort? But even small quantities matter here, right? If you reduce the idle consumption by half a watt on a modern laptop, that can translate to 10% more battery, right, which might be an hour extra. So that matters. And there's more effects that support this. Some of the effects in there aren't linear, right? So especially towards the extreme in the both in the like high performance part as well as in the idle area. Even small changes can have a disproportional impact. And then there's the scaling effect, right? That's again something you might know from Joseph's talks. He has some actual numbers in there. Because this is not a one-time local optimization, right? It multiplies over time, and it multiplies by number of users. And I'm not sure if I remember the numbers correctly, but I think within like reasonable, like our level of distribution and scale, I think you've got up to like the energy use of a small city within a year, right? So that is actually a sizable quantity. And that is our level of scale, right? If we think about browser engines or something like that, that is a completely different level. The flip side of that, however, is if we make mistakes, right, they are also going to be quite costly. So, this is important, this matters, we can make a difference. How are we going to do, or how are we actually going to optimize our software? And like with any other optimization as well, the first step is we actually need to understand what the software does. Because what the software is supposed to be doing, what we think it does, and what it actually does, more often than not, are three different things. So we actually need to have a look on what's going on. On Linux, our go-to tool for that is the Perf Profiler. Right, so we run Perf Record with the application that we want to measure, perform some usual operations in that. We get the profile file out, open that in Hotspot, and look at the details. We're going to see a few screenshots in a minute. That works for looking at a specific application. For the idle behavior, we want to see the full system view, so there we need a specialized tool, something like PowerTalk, that gives us the overview for that. And this is the result we get in this case, right? So this is a flame graph view. On the horizontal axis, we have cost, or in this case, like time spent on CPU. And vertically, we have the call graph, so you can dive into various parts of the application and see what's going on there. Now, seeing stuff in there doesn't automatically imply that it's bad, right? This is something where you look for things that shouldn't be there, things that are surprisingly more expensive than what you would expect, right? So that is the interesting things to look at. Another useful view in there is the timeline view. So each row in there is one thread. Horizontally is then the time, right? And every orange marker in there is activity on that thread over time. And as we would expect, right, during startup, you see quite some activity, and then towards the end, the application sits idle, and we would expect to not see any activity. But there's at least two threads where there's still something going on. And again, that would be something to look at, because right, we expect the applications to not do anything at that point in time, so what's going on there? In Hotspot, you can basically select that area of interest and filter on that, and then you get the flame graph for just that particular area. And then again, maybe it turns out that is necessary, or it turns out that this is something that shouldn't be there. This is the output of PowerTop. That is just a table you get on the terminal, a list of processes sorted by the amount of wake-ups they cause per second. Same thing here, right? This will never be empty and zero. There's always activity going on. It's about finding that activity that is avoidable, unnecessary, or could be done cheaper. Right, so you will see Quinn updating the screen because PowerTop printed the output you are looking at, so that required a screen output. But one example that we had recently in there was a Kate background window showing up with 30 wake-ups per second. That turned out to be an animation timer that wasn't switched off while being in the background, right? So that is the stuff to look for. So once we have identified things that we can optimize, how are we going to do that? If you're lucky, right, you find something where you can just do less. Right, that is always strictly better, but those cases tend to be rare. Right, usually it's more about making a different type of trade-off. So let's take an example. Right, you have some expensive computation. You do this twice and only use the result of the second run, right? And you just don't do the first one, easy. So let's assume you use the result in both times. Then one possible optimization would be you just store the result somewhere, right? So if the result is an 8-byte number, that is most likely always going to be a good trade-off. If storing the result means 100 megabyte of I/O, right, then yeah, not so sure anymore. So we need a way to qualify those trade-offs, right? So is that really better? And this is somewhat complicated because it can also quite easily depend on the specific hardware. So if you optimize for making the software faster, right, we usually do this by measuring the time it takes until it's done. So if we optimize for energy, that's the point where we then actually need to really measure the energy use. And that is really the only viable approach there. A lot of this stuff, as I said earlier, doesn't really behave linearly. So don't really trust your intuition. Measure this and then decide which one is better. So how do we actually measure this then? I'll focus here on stuff that you can practically do at home. So anything that requires special equipment or equipment with price on request price tags, right, that is out of scope. So if you're coming from an electrical engineering background, some of this might look weird, but that's the stuff we found for home use so far. So in terms of where can we actually measure, the first option is basically the AC side, so the power plug. That has the advantage, right, that you really capture everything that goes in. You don't miss anything. It is a bit of a problem for battery-powered devices, right? So when we talk about measuring on mobile, because you might also see the battery charging or the battery might hide some of the use by buffering that away. Ideally you just manage to remove the battery entirely. And then there's the small problem with safety, right? So AC power kind of is deadly. So if we can avoid that, let's look for other options. The secondary side, so basically the other end of your power supply, with the rise of USB-C, unfortunately, that is usually not practical anymore because you need specialized equipment to measure on USB-C. And on your workstation, it's even worse, right? You know this giant power cable that comes out of the power supply. In theory, possible, but not practical. Or at least not practical for what we are looking at here. Which leaves then the third option, and that is built-in sensors. Those are particularly widespread on, I think, standard Intel hardware and some of the AMD hardware as well. So pretty much anything sold in the last decade will have some built-in sensors. On battery management systems, you usually also have them, but they might be tricky to get access to. Right? If you have them, they might actually be a very viable option to measure on mobile. Because the big downside of those sensors is they only capture a partial view, right? So if you have a sensor only measuring the CPU consumption, anything else happening on the system will be missed. For the battery management sensors, that is less of a problem because that really captures most of what's going on. Those sensors also tend to be extremely precise, to the point of being a viable side channel attack vector. On the other hand, you're kind of measuring your measurement with this, right? So if you have a compute heavy workload, the measurement might drown in the cost. But if you're measuring an idle scenario, right, the measurement itself might be the most costly thing running at that point in time. So that is something to keep in mind. So I think that part we have to skip because that slot turned out to be only 30 minutes instead of 40 minutes. So let's get to some practical devices you can use for this. We start with stuff I wouldn't recommend you get, but stuff you might find around, and that is still better than nothing, maybe. So the thing on the left is usually something you find in a hardware store sold for as an energy monitor or something like that for relatively cheap. Those devices aren't machine readable, which means they give you an update rate of more towards a minute than a second, which is way, way, way too long. But if you manage to stretch your measurement sufficiently long, right, that might still be good enough to, say, verify if the power management setting actually had an effect. The other type of device is like server management power strips with remote switchable sockets. Those sometimes also have power management sensors, and they are Ethernet connected, so machine readable, update once a second, so that's already much better. Just the price point is usually unreasonable for what you can get out of those devices. If you have that, right, it gets the job done. More attractive is something like this. This is like a very cheap Wi-Fi power plug sold in a smart home context. Those also have a power sensor built in. And there is a free software firmware called Tasmota that works on those devices. So you can get rid of all the cloud nonsense and get high-resolution access to the sensors. It's, however, not really built for our purpose, but we managed to get like five samples a second out of this with some MQTT polling hacks. If there were somebody interested in like C microcontroller programming, I'm pretty sure the hardware is capable of much more, and we could get much better results if we wouldn't have to abuse some MQTT protocol stuff for this, but got a steady stream with proper timestamps of the sensor values. So cheap and hackable, very compact. That is probably as good as it gets. Slightly more expensive, but actually built for the purpose we actually want to do here. So really, just for measurement, is something like this: the Alcyon Power Spy 2. That's something the Mozilla people pointed us to. One downside of that thing is it comes with an ancient Windows software, and we have only reverse engineered half of the protocol so far. So for live measurements, we can use it, but we don't get to all of the other features of that yet. Significantly more expensive than the other one. Something also interesting we got to work with during one of the sprints is a development board for the actual sensor chips. The sensor chips itself are super cheap, a few dollars single piece price. So if you're into electrical engineering and building boards around that, this is great, right? And this had like a 1 kilohertz sampling rate over USB, so much, much more towards what we actually need and want. However, this is basically an open PCB running AC power through it, so okay-ish in a lab if you know what you're doing. Certainly not something you want at home on your desk with small kids around. And this is something we could get out of. I think this was done with one of those. So it's basically a plot over time for the energy use. You can see that this is rather noisy. That's not the fault of the sensor. The reason for that is in the slides I had to skip. It's massive undersampling on the high frequency of a switch mode power supply. That's why I'm so obsessed with higher sampling rates. But you still see some changes in that signal, right? So in the middle section between 100 and 150, you see that the signal overall is slightly elevated. And then there's, of course, the clear peak in the middle. And what was done there is that in that middle part, the mouse cursor was moved. And during that peak, it hovered over the taskbar and showed a tooltip. That is not meant to say that mouse moving is bad, but it shows how sensitive those sensors are. So like we really see operations on that level in there. which is extremely useful if we want to verify if our changes had any effect. Then for the built-in sensors, as I mentioned, the most common one is, I think, the one from Intel, REPL running average power something. The way to access them on Linux is also via perf. With perf list, you can check which one of those are available on your system. If you have an Intel laptop, you most likely will find a few of those. There's usually cores, which is the compute part of the CPU, package, which is the whole CPU carrier with L3 caches and the I/O controllers and whatever else is on there. Sometimes you'll also find memory and GPU as separate sensors. Those can be read out with perf stat or with the pinpoint tool. I like the latter better because it gives a continuous dump on the measurements, which you then can feed into a lab cloud or anything else to visualize this. Both tools, however, make it kind of look like you are measuring the energy consumption of a specific app or workload. That is not exactly what's happening there. Those sensors always measure the entire energy use of the system, right? So you can put in sleep 1000 as the workload and do something else, and you will measure that something else. Which is okay, you just need to know about that, right? And this is barely visible. This is then basically the result piped into labplot. On the lower half, on the upper half, is the CPU load. You can see that this is somewhat correlating, right? So if the CPU load goes up, the energy consumption goes up, so as we would expect. But you can also see like the peak in the middle, where the energy consumption goes up much more than the CPU consumption goes up. And you see some peaks where the energy used by the memory goes up disproportionately. And so that is, of course, then the interesting bits, because there's something that behaves contrary to expectations or intuition, right? So again, this is mainly meant to show you the level of detail we can get out of this with the sensors. Right, then if you have access to neither of those, right, we can also measure in the cloud. The Summer of Code project from Carinjot that Joseph had spoken about in more detail earlier. So the basic idea is the CI builds you a flat pack of your software, right? You have a test driver, a Selenium test driver for this. We run this via GitLab on the Blue Angel certification setup. It's run there several times to counter the noise and other stuff interfering, and then it applies some statistical magic to get rid of this, right? And then it produces a report with the results and plots and whatnot, so quite fancy. This takes too long to run it after every commit, but it's something you would run after major changes or before release to verify that you don't have regressions, right? So how do we put all of this together, right? So the first step is just doing general profiling and optimization. That is always a good idea. You'd be surprised by what you find in there. It helps with making the software faster for the user, and it helps, like, usually at the same time also reducing the energy use. If you're looking specifically for the energy use, the biggest impact, of course, is on long-running processes. And there's two things in there that are interesting, right? So there is continuous or frequent workloads. So for example, media playback probably has a higher impact than, say, opening the configuration dialog in Kate, right? Just because one usually runs over hours and the other one you do a few times a month. And then the idle behavior is the other thing to look at system-wide, because every single wake-up counts, right? So whatever we can get rid of there is overall helping. And the other thing you probably saw from all this repurposed random other devices and weird command line hacks is the tooling is extremely basic. This is nowhere near what we are used to from for profiling for other goals, right? There is no, but you basically end up doing some manual polling on that device and piping that in a CSV file and opening that in as a live source in Labplot and then trying to put things together. Right? There is a huge amount of stuff that could be done better and could be just also become more accessible for us as the users of it by not having to figure out each time how you put this again together. Yes, as Joseph mentioned, we have a prof on this on Monday, 10 o'clock. Anything related to the sustainability goal, I would say, but I have some of the measurement devices with me, so we can play around with those, or you can try them if you want. That's it. Thank you.
We have about 5 minutes for questions, so questions, answers. Is this more of a comment than a question? It's a question.
In PowerTop, do you happen to know what that tick underscore skid underscore timer entry that's always at the top actually means?
I think that's some kernel thing, but I don't know more detail either.
There are things that you take kind of for granted if you're developing, like say moving things from CPU to GPU is always a good thing because it's good for better feeling. Is it still true for power? That's good or bad?
That's a very good question, right? I think it's on the slide, but I didn't talk about it. Solving the same problem with a different kind of hardware, that is exactly the point where you need to measure, because there is no documented best practice. It very much depends on the hardware usually, and it's often contrary to the intuition, right? There is some documented research from the HPC people, because for them this works at a completely different scale. And I think their GPU usually outperforms CPU. But for our use cases, I think it's always measured. It's simply not known what is better for very specific workloads there.
Okay, so I have a question. Do you have any ideas how to do real-time measurements? Like, for example, you have an Android. You can see the power consumption of different applications. And do you know what do they do and how you can use this maybe on desktop?
That is a good question. I don't know exactly how they do that. This whole topic of attributing energy use to specific processes, I know that there's some research, right? We have been at some meetings with people looking into that. A lot of that is just proportional use of the CPU and then more or less guessing, right? So there is, to my knowledge, no way of measuring this with any kind of certainty, right? So it's just, on average, probably it correlates with amount of time spent on the CPU. And I somewhat guess that this is what Android does, right? It's probably close enough, just because of the big differences in there, and it doesn't really matter if it's a few percent off, but like proper strict attribution, I don't think there is the means for that.
Hi, Volker. Here, two questions from our remote participants. One is, are cheap wall outlet meters without certifications safe to not burn down your house?
I mean, those are sold as consumer devices with all the necessary certification. So they are generally safe, I would say. And we don't modify them, right? Those all are, I mean, the reason why also the more professional device has a Bluetooth interface rather than a cable interface is because it makes the safety easier, right? If you don't have a low voltage signal cable coming out of something that runs AC power, right, then you solve a whole lot of safety problems. So yeah, I mean, all of those have the CE certificates or whatever you need in your country. I don't want to take any guarantees on this is 100% safe, right? But this is like off-the-shelf standard hardware made for home use. So it should be as safe as it gets.
Thanks. And the second one, do we have a general guide with KDE, within KDE to know how to do a general profiling?
That is a good question. I don't think we have an like single place go-to thing for like a profiling tutorial. But I think there is a lot of material out there, conference talks and other tutorials on that general subject, right? It might help if we collect that and point people there. At least that part is missing, yes.
And the last question, I think, will come from Heinz.
Hi. So this was a lot of talk about measuring usage on the CPU. Is there anything related for usage on the GPU?
From the built-in sensors, if you have an Intel CPU with GPU built-in, that will also show up as a sensor. I think one of the lines in here, the blue one is actually GPU. I'm not sure if you get the same level for dedicated graphics cards, right? So that depends on whether they give you access to the sensors they have. I'm not sure if we have that. But for the built-in embedded Intel GPUs, we get that, yes.
All right, thank you, Volker. Thank you, people asking questions. Thanks to the online participants. For the real life participants here, it is lunchtime. So if you head out into the hall, you can talk to the cute stand, they're hiring, and you can talk to the sandwich people, they're feeding.